In this video, we see how a BJT can be used for linear amplification. We see the superposition method of analysis and the hypothesis under which we can get a linear amplification, and we see the hybrid PI model for low frequency. If we want to amplify the human voice, for example, we need a linear amplifier because we want to preserve the characteristics of our input signal. We want in the output the same signal we have in the input, but amplified, and for this purpose we need a linearity in the amplification, because non-linearity would introduce distortion. We can use a BJT for this, but under some hypotheses. For example, this common emitter configuration with one BJT is an amplification stage, but it is linear? We'll see later. Firstly, as we saw in previous video, we need to bias it properly. Let's say ICQ, IBQ and VCEQ are the currents and voltages of our bias or quiescent point. Once biased, the circuit can work so an input signal can be amplified. So let's say we apply an AC input signal, VI, at low frequency, which is superimposed to our DC voltages and currents already known from our previously biasing. The problem here is that we affect our biasing point because of the output resistance of the AC source in input. So we need a coupling capacitor to decoupling the AC signal from the DC signal. Same for the output, where the next stage can change the IC and VCE values, so our quiescent point. The impedance of our capacitor is this, and in DC with frequency zero, the impedance is infinite. So it is like an open circuit, so the input signal doesn't affect the DC behavior. In AC, if we choose well the capacitor, it is like a short circuit. For this analysis, we assume that our AC input signal is at low frequency in the bandwidth in which our gain is stable. So now we can apply our AC input signal VI, and we want to find our output signal. When we apply VI, we give an additional voltage to the base of the BJT. So we can write that the base current now is this, where VB lowercase letters is my input signal VI. This equation can be written in this way, and finally in this one, where VT is KT divided by Q, and it is called thermal voltage. We see that the relation between the new base current and the signal applied is not linear. But if we remember the Taylor series of an exponential, we can write this, and if VB is much less than VT, we can approximate, keeping only the first term of the equation, because the others are too little. And so we can write this, where the new base current is the sum of the base current in DC IBQ plus a term which varies linearly with VB, so with our input signal. We can call this term IB lowercase, which is the base current variation produced by the input signal VI. So we see the total current IB is the DC current IBQ plus the AC current IB. So under the small signal hypothesis, with the input signal much less than 26 mV, for example under 2 mV, we can say that there is a linear relation between the AC base current and the AC base voltage, and we can write the total base current as sum of the DC current and the AC current. Similarly, we can derive this equation for the total collector and emitter currents. Applying Kirchhoff voltage law both to the base side and the collector side, when the input signal is zero, we get these two equations. While writing the Kirchhoff law taking into account also the AC signal, we can write these other two, which become these ones, remembering that the left sides of the equation are zero. This equation can be obtained by setting all DC currents and voltages equal to zero, so the DC voltage sources become short circuits and any DC current sources would become open circuits, while these equations can be obtained by setting to zero all the AC sources. So these results can be obtained applying superposition to the circuit. So in a linear circuit, we can apply superposition to analyze the DC contribution apart from the AC contribution. When we analyze the DC contribution, we put all the AC current sources as open circuits and all the AC voltage sources as short circuits. So in the DC analysis, the circuit becomes this, and we find the quiescent point. In the AC analysis, the circuit becomes this one. The superposition can be applied only to a linear circuit, so under the small signal hypothesis. If input signal is not so much less than thermal voltage, we should consider the square, the cubic, and so on terms of Taylor series, thus introducing distortions on the output signal, which wouldn't be linearly related to the input anymore. So now we see the AC analysis because we want to find the output signal and the output gain under the small signal hypothesis. We need a small signal model for our BJT. Let's say this is the base, the emitter and the collector. We need to find the relation between the BJT dimensions VBE, IC, IB and VCE. First we know that in the BJT the IC current is related to the VBE voltage, so between collector and emitter we put a current source dependent on VBE through a constant called transconductance, because it has the conductance dimension but it relates a voltage in a junction to a current in another junction, so a transconductance. The relation between VBE and IC is linear because of the small signal hypothesis. We see it better later on. Now we remember that under the small signal hypothesis the relation between base current and VBE is this one, so we call R pi VBE divided IB, having it a dimension of a resistance. The small signal hypothesis means that around quiescent point we approximate the exponential curve with a line with a slope of 1 divided by R pi. So between base and emitter we put the resistance R pi. So we have built this hybrid pi model where the collector current is related to the voltage across R pi, which is V pi, and we want to find the transconductance under our hypothesis. We know that the relation between the total collector current and the total voltage in the base emitter junction is this. So the variation of the total current in the quiescent point is the derivation of IC respect to VBE, and it is this one, from which we can see that the transconductance GM is the collector current in the quiescent point divided by the thermal voltage. So this is our pi model, but we can add the output resistance of the BJT, remembering the Hurley effect which relates the voltage VCE to collector current in this way, where VA is the Hurley voltage. The derivation of the collector current respect VCE is this one, so the output resistance is RO, which is the Hurley voltage VA divided by the collector current in the quiescent point. Now that we have our BJT model, we can remember the circuit and we can add the other elements as RB and RC. We see that RB is between the base and the ground and RC is between the collector and the emitter, and we get our small signal model for low frequency, because for high frequency we should take into account capacitance effects and other resistances. Now we can see the gain of this circuit. First, we simplify the circuit in this way, and we get that V out is equal minus GM times V pi times the parallel between RC and RO. And because V pi is equal V in, the gain is this. After early resistance RO is very high, it can be around 50 kilo ohms. So if RO is much more than RC, the gain becomes this. The minus sign means that there is a phase shift of 180 degrees, so the output signal is the amplified version of the input. Please leave me a comment, let me know if you liked this video. Make sure you put a thumb up, click the notification bell and subscribe to my channel.